So last week, my video was all about the data dump and 11 science publications that have come out of the LOFAR collaboration. LOFAR being a huge radio telescope of antennas spread across 2,000 kilometers across Europe. And it's meant that we've been able to see black hole burps in 20 times more detail than we've ever seen before. If you haven't checked out that video yet, you can check it out here, and I'll link it up here and put it down in the video description down below as well. If you have seen it, then you'll know that in that video, I interviewed PhD student Shruti Badole all about her work on gravitationally lensed quasars seen with LOFAR. But only 5 minutes of that chat made it into the final cut. So here is our full chat, the full interview with Shruti Badole, a PhD student at the University of Manchester.
So what is your role in the LOFAR collaboration? What have you been involved with?
So my work with LOFAR has mainly been on two projects. So one is it's a study of two radio loud gravitationally lensed quasars, and the other is the LBCS, which is the LOFAR Long Baseline Calibrated Survey. And that's one of the two technical papers that we have released. So the LBCS, it's basically, it's a survey of the northern sky, which aims to find sources that can be used to calibrate the observations made using the International LOFAR Telescope. So it's a very crucial part of the long baseline pipeline. Mm-hmm. Because if you want to image an object using the LOFAR long baseline pipeline, what the pipeline does is it uses the LBCS catalog to look for sources to see if there's an LBCS sources that can be used as a calibrator for that particular object that you're trying to image. So my job was mainly to process the LBCS data and form the catalog.
So why is calibration so important for these long baseline images, this new data that's been released?
I think in general, calibration is important because no astronomy data is perfect. I mean, I wish it were. It would have made our job so much easier, right?
Totally.
Any astronomy data, it can get corrupted due to several different factors. So for example, at low radio frequencies, the main source of the main culprit is the ionosphere. Mm-hmm. So it's things like these which corrupt the data, and you need to remove these effects. Like if you want to make an image of the object, if you want to make a map that is a faithful representation of the data that you're studying, you need to remove these effects. And that is basically what calibration does.
So what did you get to study with this new data set that's been released then? After you've done all the hard work of calibrations and long baselines and all that kind of stuff, like what's the fun science?
Yes, I'll be completely honest. I have not actually run the pipeline.
But that's the beauty of the pipeline, right? Is that all that hard work is done and then you get to do science with it.
Yeah. So what I I work in the field of gravitational lensing. So my paper, it is more like, I say it's in my paper because I'm the first author, but honestly, it is a very, very, very collaborative effort. Like so many different students. Like we've got undergrads and summer students there who have worked on it. So it's really great to see their efforts coming to fruition. So when I say I haven't, so I think those students ran the long baseline pipeline to form the images. Mm-hmm. So I work, as I said, I work in the field of gravitational lensing. So what I did was study this really loud lens quasar. So it's a lens quasar, which basically means that the light from that quasar, it is deflected and magnified by a foreground galaxy that lies in the line of sight between us and that quasar. So this effect is called lensing, and it basically, strong lensing, it ends up producing multiple images of the background object. Mm. So if you're studying a lensed object, and if you look at the image, what you see is not the intrinsic source. What you see is the multiple images of the source. So what you can do is you can use the information from the multiple images to constrain the properties of the lensing galaxy and the intrinsic source. So what I did was I used a previously published model for the lensing galaxy to study the structure of the source, mm-hmm. like what the low frequency radio source looks like.
And I bet you could only do this because you had the new resolution, right? Would it have just kind of looked like blobs, I guess, without the long baseline data?
Yeah, so this is 300 milliarc second data we're talking about.
Wow.
So yeah, it's pretty great.
Yeah, I'm lucky if I get like like 0.1 of an arc second imaging optical. So the fact you've done it milli is amazing. Do you remember like the, do you remember the first time that you saw the new higher resolution image of the source you were looking at? Like, is it a source you know well? And as soon as you saw the higher resolution one, were you like, wow, or something? Or was it, or was there not that moment?
It was a very interesting feeling, I would say. Like when, I'm not sure if I'm describing it correctly, but like there aren't many low frequency, we haven't seen many low frequency lens sources. So that was definitely, it was definitely very, a very nice feeling to see, like to be like, you know, one of the first people or other to study, a lens source at such low frequency. So that was definitely great.
Yeah, that must have felt like a real like first, being like, wow, I am the first to see this in this light and at this detail as well. That must feel really good. So what can we learn by studying lenses with submillimeter and radio observations specifically?
So a lot of things, really. I think the most fascinating thing about lensing is that it lets you see faint emission that you would not have been able to see otherwise. Like, for example, when I studied this source, the magnification cost for lensing is of the order of 20, the USP of lensing, really. Other uses as well. For example, it can tell you, you can study cold dark matter substructure using it. Wow. For example, when you have four imaged lens sources, like you got sources that are lensed into four images, you are usually able to model the lensing galaxy as a smooth potential, as a smooth mass model. But sometimes what happens is if there's dark matter substructure close to the position of the lensed image along the line of sight, then that ends up perturbing the position and the magnification of the images. If you observe this perturbation, so that can give you an insight into the cold dark matter substructure. Now, why this is important in radio is because so this perturbation can also be caused by other factors such as microlensing by stars in the lensing galaxy. Now, radio is very important because the radio is immune to microlensing. So if you are seeing any anomaly like this, any perturbation, then you can use that to study constrain the dark matter. So one of the things that our group is involved in is the study of radio emission in radio quiet quasars. There's been a debate for a really long time about what the source of the radio emission in radio quiet quasar is. Like, we know the source of emission radio large quasar, it is basically aging jets that emanate from accretion of material onto the supermassive black hole. Mm-hmm. But there's been a lot of study going on, and there's still debate about where does the emission from in radio quiet quasar comes from.
And is there like a line, like with like there's this much radio emission in a radio loud and a radio quiet? Like, how do you determine what's radio loud and what's radio quiet?
Yeah, interestingly, there is debate about that as well. I mean, there's just been a lot of studies about so like there is a line. There's a clearly it was defined, but again, you know, in science, you can't really say anything for certain. Like it is, so there's this thing called R parameter, which is it's the ratio of the radio flux density at 5 gigahertz and the optical at some wavelength I have forgotten. So it said, like, if R is great, so radio loud quasars are defined as if R is greater than 10, and anything less than 10 is radio quiet quasar.
Oh, okay, so like, does the radio outshine the optical, or does the optical outshine the radio, basically?
Yes, in a way, yeah.
With some wooliness in the middle.
Yeah, exactly. So there's been like papers about the middle as well, like, oh, there should be something known as radio intermediate quasars as well. So,
RITs, yes, of course.
Yeah. So yeah, so the thing with the radio quiet quasar is, like, it's evident from the name that they are radio quiet. That is, the radio emission is really faint, and that is why that is where lensing is like really, really useful. Mm-hmm. Of course, not all radio quiet quasars are lensed, but it's definitely very, very useful to study such a faint emission.
I mean, radio lenses seem to be able to do everything. Like, I didn't realize, like, solving the problem of what the emission is coming from in a radio quiet source, like, I'd never even thought about the fact that it could help magnify that and give us a hope in figuring out where is it actually coming from. I always forget that. I'm always like, yeah, radio, it's going like holes, it's AGN, but no, yeah. So many other things it could be. You know, what's next then for your science? You're a fourth year PhD student. You know, I don't want to add the pressure, but like, what do you think is next? Will you continue to work with LOFAR data? Like what do you want to do next with your science and with LOFAR?
Yeah, well, I'm a fourth year PhD student, so I'm actually submitting next month. So I'm basically done with research. So as far as my PhD concerned, I won't be working with any more LOFAR data, unfortunately. One thing is that, as I said, there are very few, when I was talking about the cesium substructure, so you need like four imaged lens sources for that, like mm-hmm. sources that give you four images, but there are very few. There are very few of them, so you need to increase the sample of those sources. And I think so I'm not sure what's the status right now, but I think LOFAR is expected to find around 100,000 lens sources.
Wow.
So
I guess it must just be exciting to think though, like the amount of like lenses that must be buried in the current data set that no one knows are there yet. You know, these sort of is it unknown knowns? Like we know of them, but we actually, like we have the data to know them, but we don't actually know about them yet. Like that must be really exciting to think of. Like there must be one part of you that just wants to just like dive into the data and just sift your way through it to see what you find. Like a needle in a haystack.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you so much to Shruti for taking the time to talk to me. She's at the stage where she's going to start writing up her thesis, so we wish her all the best of luck. I also spoke to Dr. Leah Morabito from Durham University, who co-led this whole data dump and all of these scientific publications as well in the pipeline that made this possible. So if you haven't checked out the interview that I did with her yet, I'll link it up here in cards. And also you should look out for an interview with Fritz Zweien, another PhD student, this time at the Leiden Observatory, who works on high redshift studies with LOFAR as well. That interview is coming later this week on the channel.